Everyone, good evening, Evangelist Gonzalez. Big up yourself. We bless the Lord tonight. Buckle down. Yes, let's talk with Vivian. I have a beautiful, gorgeous guest that's coming on. Surprise, as my granddad would say, surprise. Top of the new day to everyone. Just had a good one today. Keep it locked. I don't know about you, but I'm asking God to give me strength for yet another day.
Give me faith, oh God, I pray, oh Lord,
to face another day. Top of the new day, Sister Darian, the beautiful Sister Darian is in the house. We're going to talk about sex tonight. A lot of people like doing it, but they don't want to talk about it. But we're going to talk about it too. It's real talk. It's been a minute since I've been on live here on Facebook. Here I am tonight. I have a special guest, a surprise guest. God, once again, good night, new day to the world. Yep, your girl Vivian here. This side of the aisle, it's been a minute since we've done a live on Facebook, but here we are, because guess what? This is going to be a hot topic. You know, they say hot potato. Well, this is a hot potato one. Who dares to go there? Like, real talk, Vivian. Yep, I dare to go where I know the anointing can keep me. So if you know the anointing cannot keep in it, don't chug the waters that I'm going to chug tonight. Trust me. But God is a good God. It's a good day. Put a smile on your face. Yep, wipe that frown off. You're still alive. Top of the new day to those of you down there in Jamaica. For those of you behind the scenes who will come on the scenes tonight, good night to you. Those of you who pass by, good night. I'm going to put the Real Talk number in chat because I want to hear from some of you. Yes, we'll have to say, come on, let's keep the communication going. I am playing this song because I need the strength. Yes, for the next hour or so that I'll be on. Yes, should sex be a part of the penal code? Yes, we're going to go there.
To face another day.
To the Real Talk community, for those of you joining me for the very first time, my name is Vivian. I am the host of Real Talk. Yes, the host of New Day. We bless the name of the Lord. We're going to talk about sex tonight. Yes, sex. A lot of us like to do it, but we don't like to talk about it. But guess what? I don't know. You better be careful that they don't change the law in Canada where you could just be charged. Yep, we're going to talk about it tonight. Yes, what would you do if Justin Trudeau decided to, change the penal code in Canada, making it be illegal to have sex outside of marriage? Wow. Yep, what would you do? Oh, God, help me tonight. Give me strength.
Give me strength, oh God, I pray, oh Lord,
to face another day.
Oh.
God's signs for today. To face another day.
Carry on life, Lord. Carry on.
As I said, I have a special surprise guest that's going to join me. By myself. Oh, we give God thanks and we give Him praise. Let's talk with Vivienne on this good Thursday. Good night, Facebook. Yes, good night to all my YouTube followers, subscribers, Instagram. Yes. I want to big up those of you behind the scenes, those of you who watch later. I don't know if many of you are going to endorse what I'm about to say, but we're going to go to the Bible and prove that it should be so.
Lord, give me strength to face another day. Journey a long life, Lord.
Yes.
Carry my heavy load.
This is a really Lord for care tonight. Talk line number on chat. I encourage you to use it. Yes, I'm going to be posting once again. Good night to those of you who are joining. Yep, you might want to tell somebody. Yep, go tell somebody that Real Talk is live on Facebook. Yes, we're talking about sex tonight. Sex, where a lot of us love it, we enjoy it, but we don't want to talk about it. You understand? And I say, well, guess what? We're going to talk about it tonight, you know, because, I want to hear your views on what I'm about to say. What if Justin Trudeau decided to make it law, meaning that he would change the penal code and include sex as illegal outside of marriage? And if you are found guilty of having sex outside of marriage, it comes with a 1-year prison sentence. Would you vote for him? I want to hear from you.
Give me
I'm wondering if he's going to be watching tonight or Doug Ford. What would you do if Doug Ford tomorrow said, you know what, as of January the 1st, it is now illegal for you to have sex outside of marriage. What would you do? Would you vote for him? Would the church stand in agreement with Doug Ford? Should we make sex illegal, meaning that we have to change the penal code to include it in it? You commit that act, a 1-year prison sentence. Let me hear from you tonight. I want to hear from the Christians tonight, the church people, the religious people. Would you sign that bill tonight to make sex outside of marriage illegal, meaning it comes with a prison sentence? Let me hear from the bishops, the evangelists, the religious folks out there. Let me hear from you tonight. Those of you who are behind the scenes watching, listening, let me hear from you. Sex outside of marriage. As of January 1st, it's illegal. You cannot have sex unless you are married. A matter of fact, no one can enter into Canada. With your boyfriend, you have to show proof that it is your husband. It's forbidden. It goes for foreigners and visitors. Could you imagine the chaos? Keep it locked. I'm telling you, it's gonna be hot in here tonight. We're gonna go to the mats. Good night, Nadia. Yes. We're talking about sex tonight. I'm not promoting sex. We're talking about it, all right? We're talking about it. Those of you who are doing it, those of you who are about to do it, some of you are going to go some countries, you might have to check with their immigration laws, because guess what? You might not be able to get in there with your little boyfriend. I think if they did make it illegal, you understand that sex is prohibited, not allowed, it's illegal. If found guilty, you are going to be sentenced to 1 year in prison. I want to talk about it tonight. I really want to talk about it. Yeah, but what if that were so? What would the church? I want to hear from church people, because you see, we are the religious ones. And you know, I want to hear Justin Trudeau says, you know what? January 1st, I now change the penal code. Sex is no longer, you have to be married. You have to show proof of marriage. I think that law would help a lot of marriages. And all them little sugar daddy and man are fooling upon them wife and I go up on vacation upon plane. Come on, somebody. You have to show proof that that person sitting beside you is your wife.
Give me faith I pray, oh Lord,
to face another day. I'm telling you,
Lord, give me strength.
I'm waiting for my surprise guest. I really want to start to talk. Maybe I'm not up tonight. I'm going to pick the right song tonight and I'll come and need strength. Good night, everyone. Good night. Big up yourself, your nice, nice, pretty, clean self. Each and every one of you out there, wherever you are around the world. Yes, big up yourself. Pat yourself on the back. It's your girl, Vivienne. That's in the house. It's been a minute since we've been here on Facebook Live, but you know, I decided to bring this show on Facebook. On Facebook, I can get to see the response. You understand? When I'm on YouTube, I can't really get to engage too much with the audience. So I thought, no, this too hot for dup on YouTube. Never bring it over on Facebook. And I don't want you to go anywhere. You understand? I'm trying to see, I want to hear from you. You understand? I want to hear from you. We're going to get into it. What would you do? Yeah. Sex is no longer. You can't just go on, you can't just do it when you feel like. You can't just do it to anybody you feel like, a matter of fact. Yeah, because if you get caught, you know, Lord, imagine 1 year in prison because you had sex outside of marriage. And you come out and you go do it again in another year. Maybe it's going to force some man to marry some woman and just stop off sex. Come on, somebody. Don't you agree with me? Yeah, Paul said it's better you marry than to burn, you know? Maybe the law is going to force some people to get married. I think the church should lobby this law in Canada. I guess. Come on, somebody, yeah.
Lord, give me strength
to face. Give me strength, Lord, to finish this program tonight. Good night to those of you down there in Lagos. Good night to Trinidad and Tobago. Good night to those of you in Jamaica. America, Canada, the Philippines, Indonesia. Yeah, we're going to go down to Indonesia tonight. I'm going to put in my disclaimer. I'm not picking the president down there. But I want to talk about the law that they passed down in Indonesia. Yeah, we're going to go there. We bless the name of the Lord. And those of you who know me, every time I'm praying, honestly, I always pray for Indonesia. I always call out that name. You understand? So yeah, we're going to go down to Indonesia tonight. Yep, I don't know about you, but I follow the news. And I want to write on that law that they passed down there. My good God Almighty. Yep. Those of you who plan on going down to Indonesia to visit anytime soon, make sure when you board that plane, that person beside you is your wife or your husband. If guess what? Yeah. Give me strength. I want that law in Canada. I want Justin Trudeau. And I also want Andrew Holness. Yeah. To change the penal code down there in Jamaica. That sex is illegal outside of marriage on all levels. And I want the church to support that bill. After now, me, I don't know about Una, but me now have no more sex until me get married. Yes, I'm publicly saying it. Not after this law, no. Me not going to no prison. No way. God thanks. It's real talk, you know me. I keep it real. Real issues, real people, real situations, real struggles. So people are struggling to keep themselves to themselves. So the law will help you if you don't want.
Carry on life, Lord. Carry on
every load. Guest that's gonna help me out tonight. Yeah, good night wherever you are viewing me from. Yes. Start without my surprise guest. It's a surprise, but I have a lot to say until she comes. Keep it locked, everyone. Glory to God. We bless the Lord. We bless the Lord. Yes, the guest said 5 minutes. My guest will be here in 5 minutes. Woo-hoo! All right, so that gives me time to, you know, bless upon everyone. I want to greet you up on tonight. No. What happened here? All right. I want to greet everyone up tonight, wherever you are. All protocols be established. Pick up your nice, clean, pretty self. Whether you're brown, black, purple, or pink, whether you have on a wig, eyelash, or no eyelash, you are beautiful. Glory to God. Yes, look in the mirror. Yes, you are a miracle. God bless you. Once again, my name is Vivienne. I'm the host of Real Talk, coming to you live from out of Toronto, Canada, on this your Lord's Day. It is a new day. It's new day. I'm your host. I have a surprise guest. Yes, we're going to be talking about sex tonight. Let me tell you from now. So if you're going to get uncomfortable, I think this is a time that you need to leave. Glory to God, but we're going to talk about it. Yeah, you're going to talk about it. And you shouldn't be uncomfortable because you did it. You did, unless you are a virgin, you have an idea of what I'm going to be talking about. You know, again, as I said, it's something that we like to do, but we don't like to talk about. Some people think that, oh, you know what, you shouldn't be doing that. You know, I heard one pastor, I'm not going to call any names because I'm not promoting anybody, but nobody gave me permission to call their names, but I can call, say what they said because it was public. You know, people keep bothering him and saying, oh, all he's talking about is sex and all he's talking about is this and that and that. But guess what? I think it needs to be talked about because there's people that's struggling. So all I say is this, if you're not struggling with something that a minister is talking about, if it doesn't fit you, then that's okay. When you go to Mandarin, you don't eat everything. You understand? You eat what you like, right? What's for you, what's not for you, leave it for the next person who likes that. So I think that, you know, if you're watching somebody's live and something's not for you, move on to the next live, you know what I'm saying? You know, I mean, if you don't think it's something that you need, maybe you got delivered from it. Or you know what? Maybe because you don't want to listen to it, because guess what? It's right up your alley. You understand? It's okay when we talk about something that you're not struggling with, right? We're ministers and we're men and women of God. But when we start touching on those things that, hey, that you're having trouble with, all of a sudden now they're talking about too much this, too much that. But guess what? Real talk. I don't know if you remember, we're called to unmask every secret weapon that the enemy uses to derail us. Yeah. Every issue that affects our Christian walk. And this is good. We need to talk about it. And we need to talk about this. So again, I'm here to serve with clean hands and a pure heart. Again, let all protocols be established. I'm going to kick it off a little bit. Glory to God. I want to start out with reading our scripture first, because this scripture is the base of where I'm going to tonight with my arguments or with my, you know what I want to say. According to the book of Hebrews, those of you who are Bible scholars, Bible readers, glory to God, the book of Hebrews, the 13th chapter, I'm going to read one verse. And it reads, I'm going to read Hebrews 13 and verse 4. I'm reading from the New King James Version, and it reads, marriage is honorable among all, not only among some people, but marriage is honorable among all, and the bed undefiled. But fornicators and adulterers, God will judge. I want to read that again. Marriage is honorable among all, and the bed, no sound. You guys can't hear me? Somebody say no sound. Anybody, if anybody else is not hearing me, let me know. I didn't do anything. I know when I stop playing the music, it will go down a bit, but it should come up. If anyone else is not hearing me, please let me know before I continue so I can figure out what's happening. Can you hear me? If somebody can hear me, if you can hear me, just indicate by putting up your hand or saying I can hear or something. Okay, let me turn it down. Okay, yep, mean you can hear. Everybody else? Anybody else can hear? Okay, so, okay. All right, so I'm just going to continue because I'm assuming that you can hear. All right, so again, Hebrews 13, 4, marriage is honorable among all, the bed undefiled, but fornicators and adulterers, I have to turn my phone up to the max. Well, I didn't do anything different. As I said, once the music stops, give it a little while, and I think the sound should come up. I didn't touch anything. My volume is up to the max as well. But yeah, I didn't do anything differently. All right. Is that better now? It should be, because the music stopped for a little bit. All right, so that's from the book of Hebrews 4. Let me read it again, because I mean, I stopped and talking just so that you hear what I'm saying. Marriage is honorable amongst all, and the bed undefiled, but fornicators and adulterers, God will judge. Glory to God. So I just wanted to read that as our base scripture for tonight. Yes, just kind of waiting for a little bit. Now, I want to read something. I don't know. Again, welcome to those of you who are joining us. Again, as I said with my full Facebook status, I quoted today that should sex outside of marriage, do you think it should be a part of our penal code? And when I say that, I mean, should it be illegal? Yes. Should it be illegal for someone to have sex outside of marriage? And how would you feel if the government of Canada decided to make it illegal for sex outside of marriage? Would it be something that you would endorse? Would you vote for such a government if you were called in to sit on the panel of voters that's voting yay or nay for this? I want you to indicate in chat
Would you vote for it? No. Honestly, I want you to indicate in chat, would you vote to have sex be illegal in Canada? Wherever you are listening to me from tonight, would you agree with your government to make it illegal to have sex outside of marriage? While you do that, I'm going to give out the Real Talk number. You know, those of you who feel like you want to call in. Good evening, Prophetess. Again, I'm talking about sex becoming illegal outside of marriage. Would you agree with your government if they decided to do that? You can feel free to call in. I'm going to put the number in chat for you to call us. Just give me a second. I don't call myself, so I don't know the number in my head. 07. Come on. All right, so here you have it. I put the Real Talk number. That's the Real Talk number, right? That's our phone line. Now, I'm asking you, those of you who feel like calling us in, there you have it. Feel free to use a number. If you are international, just save the number. You can call us through WhatsApp. I'll be more than happy to take your call. Again, where is everybody? Why? Good evening, everyone. Why is everybody so quiet? You know, we're talking, right? You know what I mean? Like, if you were to... I sent it. Just a second. Sorry. We bless the name of the Lord. Hold on. Just a second, guys. Sorry. Sorry, guys, just give me 1 second. Sorry. Sorry about that. Just sending. Yeah. So yeah, let me hear from you. Let me hear from you. If you were to, okay, you don't want the number. Okay. Prophetess, you're saying, okay, you don't want the number. Okay. So the phone number, that you can call in or you can text it in here, right? Let me hear from you. If the Canadian government was to say that they are going to, they're going to make it illegal for you to have sex outside of marriage. Would you be okay with that? Would you be okay with that? Ta-da! Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray! And look who it is, my surprise guest. The beautiful...
Oh, yes. Good night, everyone. Good night.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Glory to God. Yes, I'm excited. Because honestly, I couldn't take on this by myself, you know, in Africa for some backup. And who
I'm a silent supporter tonight. Don't get excited.
Silent supporter. All right, everyone. Let us welcome Minister Tamika. Glory to God. She's no stranger to us, our Health Watch co-host. Yeah. Stay tuned for next week because we're going to have our year-end Health Watch. She might give you a little bit of synopsis before we come off air tonight. So you might want to join us for that. Every year-end, she does a surprise thing with me and we close off the year. So next week, we're going to be doing that. Tamika, greet up her audience. So let's talk about this sex thing down in Indonesia. Let's come here to the church. Let's get to the word. I have some stuff. And I don't know, our believers tonight are very quiet because I'm thinking, I thought that maybe the line would have blow up. People would be saying, Vivian, I agree. Let's legalize it. Let's get it on the books. And let's get the prisons open to receive those who found guilty. But everybody quiet tonight. But anyway, go and greet up our guests and then we're going to talk.
Well, good night, everyone. A good night. Vivian called me tonight. You know, she called me today. She said, are you available? And I said to her, what is it? So I'm really glad to be here. I'm glad to join Real Talk to discuss this this serious, intimate union topic. Anyways, I don't want to do too much talking, but I want to say good night to everyone. I see my sister-in-law on. Good night, Nadia. Good night. I guess Prophetess Winnie is on. Good night. Let me see who else I can see that's on here quickly. Ooh, Juliet, good night. I just want to say good night to the whole Real Talk community. Good night to everyone joining and just God bless you guys. And let's talk about sex. Oh, yes.
Honestly, I want to say good night to Sister Clover that just joined us and those of you behind the scenes. I don't know. I don't want to say that. I don't know why do I feel that. You know, I knew I was going to do this today. But anyhow, good night, everyone. I want to talk about this law that for those of you who, I don't know if you realized it or you follow the news, but, you know, being an aspiring, you know, host and radio host and TV host that where I am going to get to, I do my part, I do my research and I try to get myself engaged. Anyhow, I don't know how much of you know that Indonesia passed a law. Yeah, they changed their penal code. I believe it was December the 15th. And they changed it to include sex. So in Indonesia, if you have sex outside of marriage and you are found guilty, it comes with a potential 1 year prison term. Wow. Yeah. Now, when I read that, I first said to myself, now, how is that going to work? Like, you know, how would they, you know, who are, yeah, how? Like, are they going to put, you know, when you come into prison, they put these bells on your foot? Are they going to sign people up? I was thinking, how is that going to happen? But then after doing my reading and stuff like that, they have put some restrictions on who can lodge a formal complaint, right? So you just can't go to the police station and say, Tamika, hey, come, that Tamika, you see her there? She just had sex and that guy was not her husband. No. It's not going to be like that. You understand? They have some restrictions.
Hey, the woman caught in adultery. They just went and found her.
but look what happened at the end. So anyway, they have some restrictions of who can formally complain. And guess who can formally make a complaint? The parents. Yes? Parents of children or whatever, who know that they're son or daughter is living with someone that's not married, they have the authority to report them. Now, those of you who are on air, you understand? Would you report your child to the authority, knowing that it's a law that they cannot live like that and have sex, knowing that the fact that you know that they are going to get a 1-year prison sentence? Could you do that to Mika, to your daughter?
Hey, you're dealing with emotionalism and morals. Oh boy, I told you I'm a silent supporter tonight. Ask the audience what they would do, okay?
I don't know. No, honestly, guys, and those of you who are on, come on, this is real talk, and this is what we're about. We talk about real issues. One of the things that I've been telling people as believers, we got to live balanced lives, and this is a country's reality. In 3 years, they're giving them 3 years to transition before the law kicks in. So if anyone there right now is living that way, they got 3 years to get married, or they got 3 years to get out of that person's house. And yeah, so I'm saying to us, if that was you, could you report your son or your daughter to the authorities, knowing that they are breaking the law? All right. Also, think about it. If they get reported by somebody else and it's found out that you knew about it, and you can be an accessory to that, are you willing to go to prison knowing that you knew about it and you did not tell the authorities? Because it's like me saying, it's a law that no one should have cocaine in their house. And you found 34 kilos of cocaine in your son's house, and you found ammunition, and you know it's illegal. There it is. It's illegal to carry a firearm without proper training and licensing. Now, it's your son. It goes back down to, you know, the morals. Would you then report your son? It's the same thing I'm asking. It's in the penal code. Sex outside of marriage, if found guilty, is 1 year. Parents have the authority to report. They're one of the persons that have the authority. Would you do that? Somebody, you're in the chat.
Let me jump on this one. Number one. So I know there's some parents who probably didn't even like the guy or like the girl, and this would sweet them, you know, to be like, yes, who can hear will feel. Now, for me, if my child is of age, let's say she knows, the biblical ways, and she has chosen what to do. All I can do is let her know what has been implemented, and that she must adjust herself accordingly, or there's going to be consequences. But me personally, no. This is it. There comes a time when they tell you you can't talk to your child after a certain age. So all of a sudden, now I must go send my child to prison. In this case, no. I'm not saying if my child is doing illegal activities, that's a complete different story. So don't think I'm one of those parents who's going to cover for my child if they're doing illegal stuff, and I'm going to just say, oh, I can't tell them. That's not, no. In this one, having to do with sex, and we're not saying sex is not serious, it is very, very serious. It is very, very serious. I want to, before we go forward, I want to give the definition of the penal code, because when you call me, I'm like, the what? The dictionary says, Merriam Dictionary says the penal code is, am I saying that right? P-E-N-A-L. It is a code of laws concerning crimes and their punishment. So in case nobody knew exactly what we're talking about, that's what it is. So I don't want to say sex doesn't have serious consequences. It does spiritually and physically. Is it warranted to be put to this kind of extent? I'm not going to share my thoughts as yet. Go ahead, Vivienne.
All right. So I want to back up now on what you said. I'm just going to push back a bit. When you said, something about, you used the word illegal, but this is now illegal because we have, you know, so it's just as if.
Right. I agree with that. What I should say, so I guess to me, I said, I don't want to say the sex dangerous. Oh boy. I am talking about things I'm thinking is going to take people's life. Again, when we get into the show later on, sex, people have killed and done all type of things. That Jamaicans would say galang bad over people, over their spouse and sex. So I'm not going to say sex is not dangerous. I'm just talking about things that I consider more, I don't want to say more serious, because to me, the ways of God is very serious. You know, I'm going to stop talking. I'm not going to stop talking because it's not about me tonight.
No, but I like how we're dialoguing, because these are some of the things that will come up. All right. So here what the deputy minister down in Indonesia says. He says this: we are proud to have a criminal code that is in line with Indonesians' values.
All right.
Now, where does a Christian values lie? He's saying that they are proud of this, right? Because it complements their values. And we're going to go.
And they're not Christian, are they? Are they Christian?
No, they're predominantly, I think it's Muslim, if I'm not mistaken. Okay. I don't want to be wrong. And we're not talking against them, because I hear that when you talk against their government, them can lock you up. So disclaimer, we're not disagreeing what the law they passed. We're just using it as to go forward. Now, they're thinking about their values. The minister is saying, oh, we're proud, because now people have to respect our values. And guess what? As we're still talking about this law, it does not only apply to its citizens, those of you who are listening to me. It also applies to foreigners and tourists.
As it should. They don't want the outside to contaminate the inside, because enough times the country has its ways and outsiders come and contaminate it. Good for them.
But listen to this. When I started looking at this and doing my little research and stuff, you understand? If you are a tourist and you and your girlfriend decided, hey, you know what? I'm going down to Indonesia. Guess what? You cannot go down there unmarried. That's what the law is. You cannot enter that country with somebody unless it's your spouse. Yeah. Now, you know that immigration paper that you sit on the plane and fill out? When you board the plane going to Indonesia, that question might be on there. You understand? If you are traveling with anyone other than your spouse, in terms of, you understand what I'm saying? That is a criminal offense. If found guilty, you will be imprisoned. So do they ask persons to identify their marital status? Maybe when you go buy your ticket in the next 3 years, those of you who plan to visit that country, you're going to have to be asked before they sell your ticket, you know, unless you're going down with, you know, just a bunch of girls. But if you're saying, you know what, me and my boyfriend's going to Indonesia, they're going to say, well, I'm sorry, I can't sell this ticket unless you're a married couple. And that's what the travel, and tourists, person saying, is that it's going to affect, you understand, even tourists and foreigners coming into that country. So basically, you cannot be living under a roof with somebody cohabiting if you are not married to that person. You know, when I first read about this, I said to myself, how is this going to work? How is this law? How would this law be, policed? Yeah. This is what the chairman of the Association of Tour and Travel in Indonesia said. He said this: it would make foreigners think twice about visiting Indonesia. As I said, they're giving it 3 years to transition before it takes an effect. So tonight, Christians. What are your views on that? Do you agree that, or would you support this law if it came into effect, that it is illegal to have sex outside of marriage? Let me hear from you. Text, we have a few people on. I don't know, it's real talk. I mean,
you guys can just type yes, no. You can just type in the chat. You don't even have to call in, just type in the chat so we can see what you guys are thinking.
Because I wanna go to the word, because you know me, I'm gonna go to the word. Because honestly, I would endorse this. Seriously. I would endorse this. Yeah. Even if the government truly doesn't want to do it. Hold on, me know y'all laugh, because me don't make up my mind already. Said me not have no more sex until me get married, because me now gone to prison. Yes. No, listen to this on a serious note, right? Mm-hmm. If we really get to the word of God, we shouldn't have a problem endorsing this. We shouldn't.
I agree.
No, let's be real. Greetings, Tanasha Smith.
Good night, Miss Mastery of Self. Go ahead.
We shouldn't have a problem. No Christian that says, you know, that believes in the word of God and says the word of God is truth, or none of us who value. Because remember, the man said that they're proud because of the values. So I don't think we should have a problem if Trudeau was supposed to impose that on us. All right, again, forget about the government. Let's talk about the body of Christ, that government. You know, maybe our bishops and our councils of bishops, you know, what if they came together and said, you know what? We're going to pass this and make it illegal for no sex outside of marriage.
Can just hear the people them talking, hear the people them say, you know, well, the pastors them and the bishop them, the priest them are not going to back it, because all of them are though. We're not talking about who has their own personal opinion. We're talking about those who are abiding by God's ways. Now, we highlighted earlier that this is not a Christian country. Now, Vivienne, we're going to talk about this only from a Christian standpoint, because we know, obviously, even if you're having sex every night and you're a Christian, you're going to say you're not supposed to. People know what they're not supposed to do, or when they're doing it, right? But I want to know if there's any people who are not Christian, or people even, I don't know if we have any non-Christians watching or listening, and if they would weigh in. Forget about being Christian. Is having sex, not being married, should it be a law? Because at the end of the day, we know off the bat what God's ways are, right?
Okay, and I like what you said, and somebody just put in chat, Juliet said, we must remember that the Bible says sex was for only married people. That's correct. And we're going to go there, right? So that's why I'm saying is that if it becomes law, it becomes illegal, we should not have a problem with it. Nobody should be saying, well, that's not right. Why would they do that? Because, oh, you know, God gave us feelings and da, 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 da. Of course, he's the one that gave us feelings, right? But we're supposed to use those. Okay, let's go to the word. Let's go to the word. Because, I mean, and good night again, Minister Swaby. I see you coming on. Sister Lovelett, good night. Again, condolence, my sister, the passing of your dad. You know, keeping you in prayer. Let's go to the word. Paul says this, for this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you abstain from sexual immorality. that each one of you know how to control his own body in holiness and honor, not in passion of lust like the Gentiles who did not know God. Okay. Another scripture. Because of the temptation to sexual immorality, each man, listen, because of the temptation of sexual immorality, each man should have his own wife and each woman her own husband. All right? Again, we talked about the unmarried. So basically, Paul says, you know what? If the unmarried people can't control their sexual desires, Paul doesn't tell them to head to, you know, go to your boyfriend's house or whatever. Rather, what did he say? They should marry, since it is better to marry than to burn with passion. In other words, we should not satisfy our sexual passion with someone other than a spouse. So I'm believing that when this law in Indonesia was passed, remember the man said that they have values. It took a long time for them to pass this law. Because I heard when they first came up with it, the young people were demonstrating, one whole stuff was going on down there, that the president had to put a delay on making the decision. So now I ask the question, thou shalt not kill, but people still kill people. What's the difference? Okay, I'm trying to understand. What do you mean? Tinashe, if you can explain that, yeah. So again, would you support this law if it came into effect? Wow. No, let me hear. You know, just type in, like, what are your views on this law? Okay, laws don't stop people from doing what they want. And that's true, right? But then again, if we say that we are believers of the word of God, right? We are to, yes, I know we don't, but in essence, we should be obeying the word of God. We should literally take it for what it is. You know, so you have a point there. You understand the law is in place for the lawless. But if the Bible says to be ye holy as I am holy, if the Bible says that we ought to abstain from sexual immorality, we need to live by these words. Do we need a government to censor our behavior? Can't we as people know right from wrong? That is true. But what I'm saying is that this government in Indonesia saw it fit to make sex out of marriage illegal. And as I said, the justice minister said, we are proud to have a criminal code that's in line with our values. So should we have or would you have endorsed this if you were on that panel? That's all I'm saying to us. When I listen to this, I really see the seriousness of this when we examine it with what we are called to do, or how we're called to live, or how we're called to conduct our lives. Because when we really look at the Word of God, it is already, we don't, as I think, and I'm thinking that's what Minister Swaby is saying, it's already, we don't need the government to put that law in for us because it's already there. It's already, we know it's already illegal for us to do it. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying, Tamika. So I don't, it according to the Word of God, it's already illegal. It's a criminal act for us to do it.
Correct. Correct.
You know, so that's the point where I want to get to, that we would need the government to put that in place. We don't need the government to tell us that, you know, when you board a plane and you're going, you know, somewhere, you understand? And, you know, one might say again, oh, well, that's for married couple. But then Paul also talks about the unmarried. That you know what, you're not married, but guess what? You're burning with your desire, your lust, your passion. I think you should go ahead and marry.
The scripture I'm trying to find, I don't remember the exact wording, but it talks about their, I don't know if it says their is it authority or law, or law, something put in place. Okay, like I'm saying, if you are keeping the law, you don't have to worry about the police because you're abiding by the law. But for those who don't abide by, they
it's a scripture that says the law is in place for the lawless.
Right.
You understand what I'm trying to say? So if I am obeying the law of the road, right? Say I'm obeying the laws of the road, I am not worried when I see a police officer. So I'm just paraphrasing
right.
What you're saying.
Right. That is
yeah, I'm
that
not is, worried.
That is the, like, I don't, scripture.
Yeah, I don't get edgy when I see a police officer. One, I know that I have my insurance. I know I have a valid driver's license. You understand what I'm trying to say? I know that it's just like Christmas time is coming. You understand? And people are saying ride is out. I'm not worried about ride. You understand? If I drive into a spot check, I'm not worried. One, I know I'm not drinking. They asked me for my license. I could present it to them. They asked me for my insurance. I have it. So I'm not afraid when I see a police officer. But if I don't have a driver's license, if I don't have my insurance and I've been drinking, obviously when I see that ride up ahead, I'm going to try to turn around or something, because guess what? I am not abiding by the law.
Correct. And yes, and you don't want to get in trouble. Although you commit the crime, you don't want to be caught.
Right. So, but I'm just saying that in this essence that we're talking about, this law from that country, and I just thought I'd come on and really hear, like, if for example, you know, we were, and I said, and again, as he said, we shouldn't have to make it law that nobody should tell us that, you know, it's not good. It's illegal.
I know one might say, well, you know, we don't need rules. We don't, I'm just saying the Christians don't, but we also have Christians who are driving around with no seatbelts, Christians who are even cigarette that says it's going to kill you, Christians who are smoking cigarette every day that's going to kill them eventually or damage their life. We're just saying there's all these things that Christians are still doing but they shouldn't be doing. And if there was a more severe consequence, sometimes some of them, so this is it. Some people learn by hearing, some learn by seeing, some learn by feeling, period. Some people can, I can just hear what happened to Vivienne and I'm not going down that road. Some people, that's Vivienne, they're gonna try their luck. And that's where the law comes in. Some of us just easily obey. Some of us need a little bit of tough love or some kind of whipping before we learn.
You know, One of the things when I like, and I mean, I really hope that, you know, people would more engage, but I guess, I don't know if it's a very touchy, you know, but one of the things that and I think he said it, you know, Mr. Rubin, you were saying it too. For us who say, like us, we're believers, right? And we know what we're supposed to do. We know we're not supposed to have sex outside of marriage.
Yep.
Right, we know that. I'm not talking about, you know, the unsaved, for example. You know what I'm saying? Who have not come into the truth, right? But that law is also for them as well, because if the law for the land is for everybody, it's not just for a particular group of people. So if that was to become illegal, it would be across the board. Somebody said earlier, I think it was Sister Juliet that said, you know, when God put that all together, it was supposed to be done between a husband and wife. It's true. We read the scripture.
Can I say something?
Go ahead.
I believe it says Jesus won't come back until the gospel is preached, right? So I guess the ends of the earth. Some people don't know about Jesus right now. Some people don't know they shouldn't be having sex outside of marriage. Not everybody knows. Not every culture believes in it. And again, that's why sometimes, and one might be like, well, it's I don't know, it's a common knowledge. I don't know. Well, isn't Christianity all over the place? YouTube, Facebook, TikTok, all these different platforms. But not everybody has heard the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
So I mentioned that to say, we say these things. Do we as so the person that asks, do we need the government to censor our behavior? No, some of us, I said, we don't. And if people who are living good, probably and righteous lives, who's never even heard of God, it's just something that's in them. Others need to hear about him and choose his ways. Some hear about him and still choose their own way. I just mentioned that to say, you know, the whole marriage thing, being in marriage, not all people know that. I had a friend the other day said to me, asked me, she said to me, is that really in the Bible? I always hear people say, is it something that preachers preach, or is it really in the Bible? And I was shocked to hear my friend who I grew up in school with ask me that. Because preachers preach a whole bunch of things that don't really, that's not really Bible. And they keep saying it so much that people start saying it. You know, people say, oh, God helps those who help themselves. That was the case. We help ourselves too much. That is not in the Bible. I know what they're trying to say, but that is not quoted like that or said like that in the Bible. What's the next one? The one from Benjamin, the Benjamin, they love say, it is not in the Bible. It is not in the Bible. But one person said, and they keep on running with it. So does everybody... Yeah, I just wanted to say that some people just don't know. And I really admire this law, because at least they're giving people time to acknowledge it, make preparation to either tie the knot, separate, or to reap the consequences of their behavior.
And I like what you said. I love that. Reap the consequence of our behavior. That's to show you that there is a consequence. So we might not have it in the penal code in Canada that says, you're not allowed to have sex outside of marriage, but we have it in the word of God that governs us.
How many people are reading their Bible?
So that's why I'm saying that although this happened in Indonesia and we're thinking like, oh my God, but to me it's like, okay, but we did, it's what's been already law for, you know, us is illegal. And there's a consequence when we break that law. Because I believe there has to be a reason why Paul would say, each man should have his own wife. We know what could take place when, look at what happens. I mean, let's be real. This is real talk. You know me already. I always say you don't go anywhere that the anointing can't keep you. So don't try this if you know. Look how much time we've heard men and women of the cloth fall in sexual immorality. Oh, yeah. Men of the cloth being seen at resorts with women that's not their wife. If every country had that law like Indonesia, they would have to show on their, could you imagine on their declaration that, listen, this is my wife, here's my marriage certificate number. That's what's going to happen. Wow, I think this is how they said foreigners are going to think twice, but they're not now. They want to go to Indonesia because guess what? They have to subject themselves to that law in that country.
What about people who don't believe in marriage? Just not for them.
Well, them live like that until them so.
I'm just saying, if the law was passed here, right? We're talking about what the law was passed here. Some people don't believe in marriage. Some people have in their mind that they're never going to get married. It's just not for them.
That, and you know what, too? That is like another whole can of worm there. Then it's like me and you, you understand? Okay. It's like me and you don't believe that they should pass the law. Okay. It's like me and you don't believe that they should pass a law about trafficking or marijuana.
Okay.
You understand what I'm trying to say? But at the end of the day, we have to abide by it, no? Because it's a consequence. You might not believe that, you know, you're not allowed to smoke a joint while you're in the subway. It's a law. Fined and prosecuted, you're going to get 25 years. But that law being in place isn't going to govern your behavior, which I think that's what he's saying. We shouldn't have to have somebody put that law in place to govern our sexual behavior. That's what I'm saying.
Again, back to that comment, as well as I believe the one from Tanasha. There are laws in place and people still do things. Yes, I agree. I believe in, I'm using the example of the seatbelt. I believe in the safety of the seatbelt. I believe you should wear a seatbelt. Some days I don't want to have a seatbelt on. I just don't. Basically, if I'm wearing a bulky jacket, I just don't want it on. If it wasn't for the fine, the very steep fine, I may not even put that seatbelt on, although I believe in the safety of it. I know the importance of it. But for my convenience and for not wanting to feel restricted, I would keep it off. Now, is that I don't know better? I do know better. I even believe I understand it, but because of that fine, it makes me put that seatbelt on every time. Do I want to sometimes speed down the road? I do, but the thought of getting that ticket makes me not know. So laws help, because even though we know better, we might sometimes want to test the waters.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. Human nature, we might want to try it out. So laws are important for that reason, because again, we all don't learn the same way. We all don't learn the same way.
And I think too, the fact that they didn't just make it law, they put a prison sentence to it, because many of us brought the law and we never get, like,
but they say you get a little slap on your
or we do it, right? But you know what, we're nothing's gonna come out of it. But you're thinking now, if I do this thing and you know what, I'm caught, I'm going to go to prison. You kind of, somebody might say, well, you know what, people still know them go to prison and still do things. Yes, but trust me, when you get caught, you understand, there's a consequence. So then it will kind of help you govern, you know, like really steer you, like, you know what, boy, I'm really want to drink, that's enough. I really want to go, but do I really want to go through that? And let's get real now. Let's get real, because all of my adults and all of you guys, if there's a virgin that's on Real Talk now, you know, just send me a text message on Real Talk. So that means I know that you're really, this is not for you. Understand? All of us, majority of us, had sex outside of marriage. We didn't follow this. Right? Right? All right.
So we have talked to talk to the audience.
I'm going somewhere with this, right? So somebody might say, oh, well, Vivienne, you're talking, but you had sex. Of course, we all had sex, because guess what? When you don't know, but when you come to the truth, and if we say that we're going to live the word of God, we got to live it, not only when it makes us feel good, but even in this situation. That we're not supposed to. I know Christians who tell me, oh, me not marred, not pussy, not bugging out. Me not do this. But according to this word that's been instituted to us, we are supposed to marry that puss in the bag.
Because if you trust God blindly in everything else, you can trust God for give the job, trust him for give some money magically, you trust him to make a way blindly, but you can't trust him for give the right puss in the bag. Oh, gosh.
I know you guys are listening to me, but I think, honestly, if we, you know, these are things that, you know, we're not going to be able to talk about on a Sunday morning or our Bible study, but these are things that we need to read, because people are having issue following this, struggling with their sexual lust and all this stuff. I'm not just talking about unsaved people, I'm talking about Christian people. Christians who are having sex. Whether it was another that's not their husband. He's not your husband. He's somebody else's husband. She's not your wife, but yet still we indulge in these things. And it goes against, it's illegal. It's a violation. God loves sex. I think he loves it. He designed us to have sex. However, within the boundaries of a marriage covenant. So then now, if he designed it to happen in the bounds of marriage covenant, and we violate that covenant, it's illegal. We have committed a crime, which is punishable by, yeah.
May I was going to say, so some people, they take the chance of committing certain crimes because they think, okay, maybe I won't get caught. Well, you know what? I'll pay the consequence. I have to say it. I believe, and I want to say this good. Me believes enough man I got to take the 1 year punishment. I can just hear someone say, no, I'm not going to.
What I like about you, because we're not only talking to Christians. We're not only talking to Christians. We're talking to every one of you out there. We're not just focusing on Christians. And you're right. You know, some people say, you know what? And some of people say, well, Vivienne, you know, you used to do it. Yes. And trust me.
Nobody's denying that. We've all had sex outside of marriage. Even once we text people, man, dead people, man. We're not saying no. We're saying that we know the word of God and we agree with it. Even if I was having sex tonight, I agree with the word. I would not justify my behavior. No, see, Vivienne keeps saying that. See, we're not talking about what we did. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. We don't believe. Okay. I always hear people say, I'm saved by God's grace or God understand. All type of talking. Vivienne and I know if we do something, whether we, let's say we get upset or we speak a way we shouldn't speak, whatever it is, we would never say God understands. We would just say, you know, I have a bad day, you know, I know it's a God, not too, please remember God, you know, go repent. We know that. We would never justify and talk about God's grace, this and God. We're not those Christians. We don't justify ways, things that we've done or things that we may do to make ourselves feel good or sound good. We don't do it. So this talking about what we used to do and whoever thinks we may still be doing it, because people have in their mindset, oh, you can't look so good and not have sex. I don't know what looking good have to do with sex. I have no idea what looking good or Vivienne bottom have to do with she. You understand what I mean? I have no idea. Because some don't have bottom, some don't look good, and they're still having sex. So, you know, all this talking, the point is we believe in God's word. We believe what we said, we understand it. We believe that God honors it and will never justify if our actions go against it. We'll never justify if our actions go against it.
And guess what? I would say that it's illegal to do that. But listen to this. As I was saying, and good point. And I know it's a bit uneasy because, as I said, this is where we become not only readers of the word, but doers of the word. The past of the past. You understand? Who need to forget deliverance, get deliverance. Who's doing their deliverance process? Now you're in your deliverance process. But if we are going to live the word of God, we just don't live the part that pleases us. If we're going to live this thing, we're going to live it in its entirety. The Bible says that we ought to be holy because he's holy. And then he goes on to say, I am the one who's going to make you holy. You understand what I'm going to say? So this is designed, sex is designed for us to have it in the covenant of marriage. And guess what? All those times that we had sex outside of marriage, all of you who continue to have sex outside of marriage, even the ones who are married that's having sex with other people, every time you do that, we are violating God's design. Yeah.
You violate your soul, you violate even the other person, you violate God, you grieve the Holy Spirit, you violate your temple. There's just so much consequence. Because if many of us are honest, what's the benefit? What has been the benefit for you? And I can just hear the other ones, well, some people are married and they're not having a happy marriage. Well, it's not everybody got joined together, so we won't even go there tonight. We won't even go there tonight.
You know, when I look at when I'm looking at this, and I was thinking, if you realize about, I would say maybe 90% of the time, maybe 90, I don't know. Somebody, you know, chat is very quiet tonight, but that's okay. I remember a pastor would say, I like when it's quite like this, because then, you know, that means people are listening. But I think if you look at this, why this sex thing and this lust thing, that 90% of the time, I would say, that you hear a leader or some church member fall down. You know what it's from? Sex. Somebody lost after somebody falling or something. Sex and money. But we're not talking about money tonight. I'm telling you.
Only three things they say. Sex, power, money. Nothing else. Those are three things that's always going to get you to fall. If you have the money, you might be able to get whip a sex, whip a girls, or buy it. If you're in power, and even if you don't have any money, all three of those things will get you to fall. They all work hand in hand. They go together.
And as I said before, and I've asked, and I didn't see anybody respond, you know, if it were to become law in Canada, our prime minister, his cabinet said, you know what? We're going to make this law that sex outside of marriage comes with a prison sentence of 1 year. So we're going to amend the penal code. Will you endorse it? Would you endorse that? Sex outside of marriage mocks the Creator's will.
And are we talking about sex between a man and a woman? Or what are we talking about now? this marriage law.
No, I'm saying if they change.
No, I'm just saying overall, and even if they did it here, are we talking about marriage between any type of persons?
Well, that's a whole. I'm instituting marriage according to the Bible between a man and a woman.
Okay.
So if anybody wanting say, well, it now I've got a mana, umana, you decide, say, well, me want, well, that's a whole nother can of worms. I'm not going there tonight. I'm talking about the institution, the marriage between man and woman, that if the government were to, would you endorse it? Do you think, you'd support it? Would you march against it? Would you say, no, it's a violation of my freedom of choice? I should be free to make that choice or not if I want to have sex outside of marriage. That, you know, because even in the body of Christ, you have people that say, listen, you know,
that's something kind of the body of Christ never agreed on anything, never. But there's a day of worship. Whether it's what to eat, what to wear, the vaccine, we're never all on the same page. And it really is a shame.
Again, good night to everyone that's joining us. Those of you who are behind the scenes, we're just here talking about the law which was passed down in Indonesia. That country has now put in place that sex outside of marriage is illegal, and if found guilty, it comes with 1 year prison's jail time. I'm quoting the deputy minister, justice minister, who said, we are proud to have a criminal code that's in line with Indonesia's values. And that speaks a lot to me. Just the word values. So then we look at ourselves and ask the question, would you endorse a law like that? Would you, because you're able to abide by it, or you wouldn't because you're not able to abide by it? You know what I mean?
Yes, yes. I would endorse it, one, because it's God's way, and two, also because it would help to keep me in line if I decided I wanted to go out of line. I'll be thinking, the consequence.
You know, I was sitting today and I was thinking, I'm like, a law like that, I think it will save a lot of people. Maybe even a lot of marriage. I don't know if I would say it would save marriages. Or, you know, I don't know. I look at and I see, like, okay, how would it, you know, other than the fact that we are abiding by the word of God?
Oh, may I?
Go ahead, please.
That just seems like, that just seems one-sided to me. I'll tell you why I say that, because, you know, Canada's all about the economic growth. Now they're thinking losing tourism, people who are now living together. Some women cannot live without a man because their income is not enough. Some people are going to lose their houses. They're going to get downsized. They're going to have to figure out how they're going to manage. We don't know if they're going to become heavy on the system. Years ago, people used to hide, welfare hide, that they didn't have no man in the house, put on a toilet seat, change around the house when workers used to go in the house. All type of things I used to hear they used to do because they couldn't have a spouse in the house. Now, some people would have to, I think financially it would become a problem for many people. Some people, again, don't believe in marriage. Common law is very I don't know what the number is, but it's very large, and people don't mind it because it actually gives a lot of rights, and as like a married couple, if you live with somebody for some amount of years and you separate, it's kind of like you're married. The laws that surround common law, I think it would cause I'm talking outside of the church, you know, talking about people being faithful. Because on the other side, I believe it's wonderful people keeping themselves to themselves. I want to talk to all the young people that might come on here. You see, Mary, if Mary didn't keep herself to herself, she couldn't carry the Savior. People think it's not cool. It's not cool to keep themselves. But if you, if God was looking to use somebody, a young person, and everybody was having sex, there wouldn't have been anybody. But Mary, who kept herself to herself, is a very good example. It is a good thing to keep yourself to yourself. Now, some marriages might, some people who are just married for the sake of convenience, it looks good. Arrangements might resent it because they don't really love their spouse and they're satisfied on the outside. Not only the Christian community on the whole, I think it would strengthen the body because we would walk in the right way. Now, you said earlier, the Bible said, be holy as I am holy. And people are like, oh, we can't be holy like God. I heard somebody say so simply. They said, being holy is not about being perfect. It's about really each day getting up, thinking like God and thinking how to please him, walking in his ways. And that's really it. It's not about being perfect. It's about striving and doing your best to stay with him for the things that don't give him glory and don't please him. And to be Christ-minded, Christ-like. That's all it is. That's all it is. It's not about, you know, oh, I'm never going to fall down. I'm never going to this. It has nothing to do with that. So we are more than capable. If God tell you don't do it, it is possible. God tell you don't do it, it is possible. God gives you the grace for everything he commands you not to do. But for some reason, the church thinks it's only sex alone. God not getting the grace for. The amount of grace for heal, raise the dead, preach, sing, do all type of things. When it comes to sex, God throw away the grace for that. Yeah, God not have no grace for that. Throw it away. And that's really, the Bible says what you're drawn away by your own, what? Desires. You talk like that because that's your weakness. Some people's weakness is not sex. Some people's weakness is not sex. So they don't have that problem. They're not going to talk like you. They'll never talk like that. People only talk that way. People, I can never do that. I hear people say, oh, I can never give up that kind of food because that's your weakness. Food not going to make me have diabetes and high blood pressure and all type of things. No food. Before that, I discipline myself to fast. There's no food on this earth. No fried chicken, no ackee and sausage. None of that's just going to take me to the grave because of my belly. And I said, because I always hear people speak about things that they're weak to. Go ahead, Vivian.
Okay, let me just read this comment in chat. Do you really think jail time is appropriate? Don't you feel that this is a little harsh and this behavior being going on from the beginning of time? How could they endorse it anyway? Who do you think they are trying to protect? And that's a good point because that's what they were saying too. You understand, in regards to down there that, you know, it's going to benefit certain people or certain people are going to be, you know, weighed in the balance more. They're talking about because there's people that's advocating against it and all that stuff. Right. You know, the jail time. But I'm just saying my thing and why I'm just using this so people can see where I'm going. I'm just saying to us that although they're doing that, we know already it's illegal. That's the part that I'm looking at. I'm not even, you know, saying, okay, well, Trudeau should lock us up. I'm just saying, in fact, that we know already that this is illegal. We know already that it comes with a consequence. With them, they're talking about the physical jail time. But you know, do you know when you have sex and you commit adultery? You understand? Isn't there a consequence? If you went out there and committed adultery with somebody else, you violated your wife, there is a consequence. So let us go, like their consequence they're talking about is sending them away to prison and locking the physical bar. But when we, you understand, violate in that way, there is a consequence. You ever, come on, some of you are on here, you're Christians. You understand? We just get saved and your Holy Ghost feeling you have sex with a man. Trust me, the consequence of that, sometimes many of us will live it. Oh, when God pardons us. Do you know much persons who go outside of their marriage union and have sex, right? and another child comes involved. You understand? That and that wife or that husband decides, you know what? I'm out. That's a consequence. That's like your sentence that you got. You understand? Your jail time. That you violated that union.
The fear of your spouse finding out and ruining your whole family, your business, your reputation, like all type of things.
That's like a sentence right there. You know, yes, God will pardon you and forgive you, but then there's a consequence.
The problem is mankind is too concerned with what they see physically. They're not concerned with what happens spiritually, period. Period. So, go ahead.
What I'm really saying is that, you know, according to the word of God, you understand, sex, that's it. It should happen between a wife and a husband, your spouse. We should not be having sex with anyone else. Simple, black and white. Am I right or am I wrong? Somebody help me.
Nobody not help you tonight, you know. Nobody not help you tonight. It's all me. No.
No, seriously, somebody. Let's just plain black and white. The in layman's term, no sex unless you are married. Unless that person is your spouse. Fine. You used to do it. You have your children, you know, you know the word of God, allow it to govern you. We've all messed up. We all used to do it. But I'm just saying this when I'm talking about this country and just bringing it into, you know, how we're supposed to live. There is a sentence. There is. You know how much women right now can't have kids because what? They went outside of their marriage union, had sex with somebody, caught an STD, and that was it. Chlamydia or whatever. They can't have children. That's the sentence they got. Like, so you see what I'm saying? Because you violated. We want to talk about Brother David in them. Trust me. And you know, I mean, I'm sure, you know, and I'm just paraphrasing, you know, many of us, you know, even though said never female wife, he knew. But guess what? He violated, and there was a consequence. That would have been his time in prison. We might say, oh my God, was God too harsh to let the boy, the baby die? No. You violated. There's a consequence. And every time we violate God, we will have to face a consequence, even although he forgives us. Many of us today are still living the consequence, although we've been forgiven.
Yep. You look around, the children you had is a reminder. The scars you have is a reminder. The gunshot wound you have is a reminder. The injury you have, the lack that you have, it's a reminder. Although God has forgiven you, yeah, sing from the choir, preaching, you're feeding the hungry, it's a reminder. There's consequences.
And this is where his grace comes in and cares too. But so there's nothing that anything that we do to violate the principle and the ordinance of God, he'll forgive us.
He'll forgive you in prison. Be going to stay in there under your time. Yeah.
Perfect analogy.
Yeah. Of course. God will even talk to you, and the Holy Spirit will even come in there and be with you. But you're gonna pay. You're gonna do your time.
You'll preach the gospel in there, lay hands on the sick in there.
Oh, yes.
And all that stuff. You're forgiven, you're a free man, but guess what? The consequences is that you have to do your 25 years. It might favor you and cut it down, yes, but some people, the consequences, again, you lose your family. Your children don't want to have nothing to do with you. That's a consequence.
What am I saying? Wasn't there a law, didn't you know better? But they still did it.
I think Tanash said they still did it. So that means you like to traffic drugs?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Against it? All right. You love money? Go ahead. But guess what? There's going to be a consequence when you get caught. So all I'm saying is this, you know, I don't know how this government is going to do it, but I guess they know how they're going to do it. They're going to transition into it because they value their values. They want to live by their values. And I think each of us as women and men, if we should live by our values, we would not sleep with nobody unless they're a spouse. We would not lower our values. Many of us did it over time. What we get from it? We just feel dirty and nasty, full of regrets. You know, I don't know about you, you ever sometimes look back and think some relationship you have and you say, my God, what me to do? You know, honestly, I don't know about anybody else. I'm telling you, it's the truth. You understand? You figure now, what were you thinking? What were you thinking when you were sleeping with that man? What were you thinking? And it's because we moved away from the ordinance and the principle of God. And that's what I'm saying tonight. And it's very quiet in the chat because this is real thing. It's a real, real thing. Sex outside of marriage, not allowed. There's no, well, I'm going to get married to him. Or he's my fiance. You know, it's people I know got engaged and I never got married. Engagement doesn't mean that that person is going to be your husband. You know, I had the privilege of marrying a couple on the weekend. And I practice this. Well, I don't advertise that I marry people. It's not something that I do. But anyways, people, you know, would recommend anything. And I received their license after I went to counsel them. And me, I don't do nothing to that license until the day. It's when I arrived there because any game can play. And seriously, anything can happen. I'm not quick to fill up that license and, you know, go ahead and fill up my part. No. One, anything can happen that something, God forbid, something could happen to me and I wouldn't be the one to perform it. At least their license, I could probably call a colleague to do it. Or they themselves might say, you know what, I'm there, nobody show up. No. Because anything can happen. Because he puts a ring on your finger, it means that, you know, you can lay with him. You know how much men I know that person or hear of that didn't marry the woman after that? I know somebody for personally. So all I'm saying is this, that if we're going to live the word of God, it includes this part.
Pastor Nash, somebody is talking to us. Somebody is talking to us.
And what are they saying?
Let me go over. Let me see the last chat. They said, they agreed with you and everyone. They said, sex outside of marriage is not for the child of God. I believe they just came on not too long ago.
Oh. Blessings, Pastor Barbara, Morning Dew host. Yes. Woman of God, you might have just come on. We're talking about the law that was passed in Indonesia, where they made it a crime if you have sex outside of marriage. It comes with a 1-year prison sentence, and they're giving 3 years to transition into the law. It also applies to foreigners. The head of tourism said foreigners now have to think twice before they go to Indonesia, because they cannot enter into that country with a boyfriend or girlfriend No, it has to be their spouse. And they're either going to have to answer if they're married or not, or show proof of marriage. And we're just comparing it that to the body of Christ. If we would endorse that, that's sex outside of marriage is illegal. And I'm saying is that we already know it's been illegal from before we even got here. So we don't need Trudeau to change the law to let us know that sex outside of marriage is not acceptable and it violates the ordinance of marriage. We've all done it, as I said. We've repented of it and God has forgiven us, but many of us are still dealing with the consequence of that by his grace. So all I'm saying is this. If we are going to live the word of God, we're going to live it, all of it. You know, we're not just going to live the part where it says, oh, love your neighbor as yourself. No, we're going to live the part that says that sex outside of marriage goes against what God has demanded us to do. Many of us know your Bible. I have a lot of Bible scholars here, and you know me already. I don't want to just come talk at the top of my head, because you might say, well, you know, this and that. But the Bible says it. You know, go and read Genesis 2, 24 to 25 even. Read Genesis 4. I'm just giving you some scriptures to go and read. Chapter 4, verse 1 as 25. You know, even in the early stage, it says, thou shalt not have sex before marriage. Because guess what? When we have sex outside of marriage, it flows against God's design. Yeah. Wow. Look what happens when, you know, you talk about Abraham, his sexual relationship with Hagar. Look at that. Mm. If you check in the entire Old Testament, it was designed, sex was designed for marriage. Go to the book of Deuteronomy, because I'm telling you to go to the word of God, because it governs our life in every single way possible, including our sex life. As I said, a lot of us love to have sex, but we don't want to talk about it, especially when we know we're violating. Just like how we used to have sex and it nice to you and everything and all of that, but you didn't know in your head that we were violating God. Because we're in darkness. We didn't understand what we're doing, let alone we come.
So I guess that parent would send their child.
Yeah. What is it? Oh, who would that man behind the law? I want to meet him and send my children in the. No, listen, you know what? We have somebody we want to talk to it. You see what this, what she said? She would send her children. Because guess what? That law, if it was in place, would in essence govern. And, you know, although you said some people know the law is there now and them still go fornicate. You understand? But guess what? No, as long as you're willing to pay the consequence. Mm-hmm. Now when we go and fornicate, when Pastor so-and-so takes Sister so-and-so to Jamaica and spend 1 week at a resort, you understand? And do whatever. They didn't just go down there to have secretary meeting and stuff like that. To them, there's no punishment as they seem. They come back, you know, they do their stuff. And I'm just paraphrasing now. But in this sense that this country's doing, you understand what I'm trying to say? But I'm just saying that the word governs. Deuteronomy condemns a soon-to-be wife who had sex before marriage. Go and read it. Deuteronomy 22, 13 and to 19. Come on, somebody.
I want to say something. I'm sorry, Pastor. Do you have any more scriptures to read? I don't want to.
No. Go ahead. No. That's it. I just wanted to refer, because you know me, if I refer to the word, so people can see, I'm not just making this up.
I'm with this person. I don't know them personally. Genesis, Joseph. Yeah. So I'm in agreement. As I'm sitting here, I'm thinking, there's a spirit behind everything. In the same way, you know, it's not, we don't just not have sex because it's just what God says. We get to a place where we desire to please God, and sex is not on our mind all the time. It's upon your mind all the time.
No, come, me no want God prison.
Okay. First of all, you know, you're not. That's just tonight. So it's upon your mind before tonight.
No.
So I'm just saying. I remember when I used to have sex out of whether it was, you know, people say, oh, lonely, you want company or whatever it is. Yes, I mean, there's something, and I'm reading the comment about the deliverance in that form. People are having sex for all kinds of reasons. We need to forget the spirit behind this need, this urge to have sex. Because sex is not just the act. There's something inside. What is it that we're desiring? Why we're doing it? Yes, I mean, it's one thing to give a law and tell your children, don't have sex, and you know, tell them you only see your boyfriend on Monday, and you have 1 hour and be home by 6 p.m. And yes, I mean, but how do you get rid of that thing inside? You know, what is that thing? What causes us? Why is sex such a downfall for us, Pastor Nash?
But you know, the thing about it is too, and you use a word, and I probably don't have the answer, but when you look about it, as I said, sex is a good thing. God designed it to be a good thing. Just like how everything else is a good thing. But guess what? A good thing that is misused will become a dangerous thing. And that is not what it's supposed to be. But because we've used it wrong, outside of the covenant it was supposed to be. Now, as you talk about it, you know, you ever sit down, and those of you are on, you're big people. You ever sit down and think about all the sex you have and you wonder, no, seriously, like all the time. Yeah, sin against God, and you violate God, and you know, and yeah, come on, we were doing it. Because I don't know, this is what you see, the word of God, it comes to clean us up, it comes to bring conviction, comes to bring repentance. You understand? Because even me, I'm not saying that I had to hear this news in Indonesia to let me know, you know what, you're not having sex outside of marriage. But when it brings you to that conscious state, till you start looking, you're saying, even like next week. You understand? Even if Mrs. Six Pack, 10 Pack, whatever, me myself, I go remember, listen to me, keep yourself, because you're violating. If I just think, if we say we love God and God is holy and he's righteous and want to be vessels of him, and when we get to that, we're talking about sex now. There's all of them, but this show is about that sex law, right? So that's what we're talking about, sex. So if you come on here and you hear, why are we talking about sex? Because this is what the show is about, because we're talking about that, right? You find yourself, no, I'm not doing it. Because guess what? If I knew way almost years ago when I was having sex, like, that I was really hurting God, if I was aware of that, even when I was saved, because someone act like one of those saved whenever they have sex, you were still having sex. You understand? So even when, you know, you were saving, you were doing it, I didn't understand. I thought, you know what, you know, I wasn't hurting anybody because it was just me. I was just gratifying my flesh. You understand what I'm trying to say? But now when you think, oh God Almighty, all those times you were violating and you were just, it's like you were, no. It makes you conscious the next time. Listen, it's not about me satisfying my flesh, Tamika. It's about me pleasing God and being obedient. You understand? And those of you who are having your flesh problem, ask the Holy Spirit to help you to master your flesh, that you can't control it. You know, you just, he'll help you. He'll bring it.
She never said a master, but you know, she said a master.
Yes. Thank you. Yeah, thank you for saying that. That's not what I said, because you know, sometimes I hear wrong. I didn't say that.
I'm just making joke.
You can ask the Holy Spirit to help you. Help you. Don't ask the Holy Spirit to take away the feeling from you. But those of you who, because you're going to be in trouble, because when you, Holy Spirit, take that from you, and you get a man now, a husband now, not a man, a husband. And then you, you know, what's going to happen, right? Ask him to help you. You know, help me to live this word that governs sex in regards to covenants.
Yeah, give you a healthy appetite, right? Someone will have out of control appetite, and that can be in anything. It could be in eating, in talking, in whatever, stealing. We have very out of control appetites. God is able to fix it up.
Yeah. You know, let me just read another comment that Pastor Barbara wrote. We didn't know better, but now we are praying for our children. Thank God for raising up somebody to stand against that. Somebody to stand against that. Amen. We need to, honestly, you see, as I said, we're so used to talking about so many things, but these are the things that our young people are struggling with. I think this is what we need to, young people service, you understand, youth meetings, they need to talk about these things. Let the young people know, listen, yes, we know you're getting to adolescence. Yes, we know that your flesh is talking, but this is what the Bible says, you understand? Because then if we instill this in them, we'll have less pregnancy in the church, you know, choir leader and choir director sleep together, two of them in a church, you know, pregnant. You understand? Or maybe, you understand what I'm trying to say, but if you instill in them, listen, I know this is this, that, but this is what the word of God said. Let it govern you. Let it, you know what I mean? We need to do that as the woman of God said. You understand? She wouldn't mind setting her kids there. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. I'm gonna lie to you, Pastor Nash. When I say young, when I say young girl, I'm on the road. I saw one of the, she can't be more than 14, pushing the stroller, and I'm just thinking, you don't even know the delay you've caused yourself, and that's not judgment because I too was a teen mother. We cause ourselves delay. Doesn't matter how you're forgiven, and people say, oh, you can still do what you want to do. There's a delay. Because if you wanted to do something with 100% ability and time, it's cut down to even 50% sometime. Mm-hmm. If you don't have help, you don't have the finances, you're limited. It grieves when I see all those young girls on the road pushing stroller. Hurts me. Because what? Sex.
And you know what I want to say too, especially for persons who are designed to be married and all of that stuff. You know, I mean, I don't know, if somebody could push back on this, but I believe that it's, I don't know, I think for me, and I'm publicly saying this, yes, I had a child of wedlock, yes, I was having sex and all that, violating God's laws and not even knowing it and all that.
You go to prison way by time already.
A lot of times, I'm telling you, but that's why I'm thanking God for grace and the blood of forgiveness, the blood to forgive that's shed for my sin, and I'm forgiven. Right now, I think every woman, if you're honest with yourself, and I say this to myself, I want to know, you ever just, I think that it just, there's a sense of feeling that when you're married to somebody, that man has no idea. You know what I mean? Like, you just stand so clean and so pure, because guess what? You don't know, you don't want to, you understand, have, because, okay, a lot of us women, me and know Tamika, Lord help the Holy Ghost. When you're having sex, right, with that man, in your mind, you're saying to yourself, you're making sure that you do your best, because, oh, you now make him forget you. You have to remember, you know, matter if you take the boat, go to Indonesia, you're doing your best. Right? Listen. And the guy keep coming back, because guess what? He's coming back because of that. You don't even know if he really love you. You understand what I'm trying to say? It could just be because you're dead. But when you're for, you know, and then people are going to push back and say, well, you can marry a man and he you never had sex with him, but maybe after you had the sex, he's gone. You know, I don't think that is, the percent on that is very high. honestly. Because for me, for you to say to a man, you understand, this is my standard. This goes back to values. What the deputy minister said, I'm going to repeat the one the man in Indonesia said. We are proud to have a criminal code that is in line with our Indonesian values. What is your code, penal code, when it comes to your body and sex?
A lot of people don't even have any standards towards their own body.
Exactly.
Don't even have any standards towards their own body.
So when you say to him, listen, this is my, I value this part of me. This is my standard. You understand what I'm trying to say, you know, and again, you might push back and say, well, you know what? You could marry and leave 6 months or whatever. The fact of the matter is you value yourself. That you're not going to put yourself in a compromise because guess what? You're being governed by the word that says to you, listen, I gave you that feeling. I gave you that desire. Sex is a good thing. But guess what, Vivienne? This is the only time you can have and enjoy this design that I've given you is in the context of marriage, the covenant, sorry, of marriage. All those other times, then you might have people that says, well, you know, then if God didn't... we did it out of the marriage, we have kids and he blessed us with kids and all that stuff and blah, blah, blah. Hello. If we look at the truth, look at how some of our kids came out. Talk the truth. Yes,
I need to be reliving the same things.
Exactly.
They're doing something that you are doing, and you know you have to try it. No, try.
Tell the truth. Come on now.
Yeah, they're blessed, and maybe they have good jobs and all type of things, but it's not isolated from other things.
And I'm not saying that kids who were born with husband, mother, and father married is better than kids who are not. But if you look at the trace, though, because now you have a man who has a child with you, he has a child with somebody else, he has a child down the road there, you have one with Dom, another with Harry, another with that. Now the dynamics, yes, God bless you with children, but then look at the dynamics now that you're dealing with. So all I'm saying is this, Indonesia passed their law. I like what the guy said, their values. Now they do a prison sentence or whatever the case is. Somebody said that's harsh, but I'm just bringing it now into us that our prison sentence for violating the ordinance of that could be some women can't have kids, got them get STD, chlamydia, all sorts of something. You understand, whatever, you know, you still end up don't have no, whatever the case is, there's all the consequence. All I'm saying is this, if we're going to abide by the word of God, we're just going to live it, all of it, not what makes us feel good, but even the ones that doesn't make us feel good, but it's the right to do. It's the right thing to do. And I think that we should be encouraging our young people in this, our daughters and our sons, to keep themselves. To keep themselves. Because the enemy uses that which God has made to be a good thing. Look how he uses it. Look how you have men preying on young girls. Raping. Look how the enemy... raping and all that stuff, that which is sexual, Jesus have mercy, what was supposed to be good, you see how when it's in the hand of somebody doesn't understand it, you can use as a force of evil. Yeah, and that is why we need to really pray for our next generation when it comes to this. And even us, we're older. As I said, nowadays, a lot of churches, You understand how much time you're here, Pastor so-and-so, sexual conduct, or Bishop so-and-so has been charged with sexual this. Here on the real, or Bishop's charged with stealing church money. No, sex. You understand? The devil's, yeah. And for a leader like ourselves, believers, to fall in that, that means we violated the principles of the word of God. And that is the consequence of doing that. Keep yourself to your wife. Keep yourself to your husband. Paul said, for the unmarried, you understand, you can't control yourself. Just get married. It's better to marry than to burn. Because in essence, you know, said Tamika, we think that, just having sex is having a good time. Let me tell you something. Some connection, some soul ties. Let me tell you something. This is not just, if people understand, you know, it's people right now are battle with some soul ties because of sex or that are married. You have this little man in a year. You have a next little man in a year. You have that little man in a year. You have everybody who them sleep with in a year. I'm telling you, that's why some people are so having a hard time in their marriage now.
Well, the young man asked,
about
the consequence. Yeah, we're gonna come down just now about the consequence. Isn't that too harsh? Now, first, when you're talking, and I was thinking, wow, you know, it's a criminal act. I'm thinking, when you think of a criminal, you think of somebody who, you know, kill off people and armed robbery and something big and dangerous, but no. You know, when you break things down, it really is applicable to this being punishable. Criminal, off involving or having the nature of crime, relating to the administration of the penal law, guilty of crime. That's criminal. What is a crime? A crime is an act that breaks a law that relates to how to behave in society. I'm going to jump now to our next line. A crime is an offense that merits community condemnation and punishment, usually by way of fine or imprisonment. That's it. It's not about whether it's because the question is, what is a reasonable consequence? You get spoken to, but you're going there for overnight, but you go for 1 week. You go for 1 month. What is reasonable? What is reasonable? Now, we can say having sex it shouldn't be punishable because people are doing it. Okay, all right. Outside of the context that the law is made, as well as what we're talking about biblically, it is a crime. It is. So again, we're going back to, as Pastor was talking about, you have this person in you, that person in you, number one. Oh, let me say something quickly. She mentioned before, she doesn't want to go to jail. You see me, when I know that I violate God's law, I don't need to be locked up in prison. I know that my guilty conscience alone torments me for days, all week sometimes. So I don't even want to talk to God. I don't think God doesn't want to hear me. I am so disappointed in myself that I don't go to him. You know what I mean? There's like a distance. Sometimes, you know, if you're going on good, it's like if you know that you're going to the gym all the time and you miss a week, if you could have lifted 20 pounds, you might go down to 15 because you lost momentum. When you sin, you lose something. You guys can form, fool, and act like you don't know what we're talking about. Spiritually, you lose something. Come on. We can call it your anointing. We can call it, if you're going up in level spiritually, you'll come down a notch. There is something that you've just done to stagnate your growth. Come on. Now, you guys can all act like, oh, 1 year in prison is long. But many of us are suffering for years of spiritual, we'll call it imprisonment. Spiritual delay, spiritual hindrance, obstacles because we've sinned. Yes, I mean, that's what you call it, what, generational curse? Because something is taking your generation before, it's now taking you, and it's stagnating your life.
That is worse than the one you're in jail. At least when you're going, you know you're coming back out. Spiritually, sometimes we don't identify and we never come out. When you violate yourself, which is what, the temple, it's like violating God. It's like violating God. If you knew God was lying down beside you, would you go have sex? If you knew God was lying down beside you, would you go have sex? No, some people bare fear still, but I don't know. That's what I mean. But if you knew God was lying down beside you, would you have sex? And I said, because we think we can just keep with the, not a big deal. It is a big deal. It is. And I don't want to make it, and we're talking about sex tonight, but we want you to know, we believe all the things that God says. With lying is a big deal. Lying sends people to prison. Lying can let you lose your job. Lying can make you lose your family. Lying can do all type of things. Yes, I mean, just the things from your words, even that itself, your words bind you. They get you into trouble. They sink you. It's like cement. It holds your foot. Certain words that you say. So even words itself, some of us should be locked up for things that we're saying.
Mm.
So we're not just, we don't just only believe in sex, but because that's the main topic for tonight, we believe that every spiritual, everything that God says don't do, every spiritual violation that we do has some kind of stagnation and delay and hindrance. And it puts you back spiritually. It puts you back. Puts you back. God showed me a vision once. I'm going to share it with you. God showed me a vision once about, you could say, taking offense or unforgiveness. And he showed me spiritually that you do go to jail. Mm-hmm. He showed me spiritually that you do go to jail. He showed me three levels. At the time, I didn't even study. I didn't even know the different jail systems. I still didn't think I even know them properly now. But he mentioned there's the first level, you know, so you're aware that you have unforgiveness and he talks to you. It's kind of like the police officer telling you to pull over. Let's say you're speaking to the officer, you pull over. You see the officer, you have two options. Do I ignore the officer or do I pull over? If you pull over, that might be God, you know, warning you, hey, you have some unforgiveness or some offense or whatever it is. All right, take you get your warning. You might have to keep going. Now, if you decide that you don't want to take the warning, you want to keep going, you decide, oh, may not forgive them this week, may not forgive them next week, I'm going to stay vexed. Yep, all the next month, the year passed. Yep. Now you end up in a jail cell, not just overnight, but for weeks, even months. Some people are waiting in jail now for trial and all type of things. And that's the second level. When you choose to not take heed to the warning that God has brought to you, whether by somebody telling you, your conscience is telling you, the Holy Spirit, whatever you know, you hear a sermon, you're like, yeah, you know, so I really have that problem. And so there's warning. You get warning. Then you end up in the jail. And then if you decide, nope, not going to forgive them. Nope, not going to move on. I'm not going to let this thing go. Pastor always says, give me the line, Pastor Nash. We don't master will master you.
Yeah, what you don't master will master you.
Yes, and I believe your friend there said the same thing in different words in the chat. So the third level is if you don't, you decide you're not going to give up, you go, so let's say you're in jail, you're a few weeks, down months, you're going for the judge is talking to you, you know, you plead guilty and you said, you know what, I'm not letting go of this thing. Whatever this thing is, could be a habit, it could be the offense, the unforgiveness, whatever it is. All right. Well, you get locked up and you go to the big prison. There's two options. You get a whole heap of years or you even get life. Now life is when you decide you're not going to change. And then you end up going what? Downstairs. You get lots of years and you might decide at the end of the time, you know what? I'm going to let this thing go. That's how people wait till they're old. They want to do right by God. They wait till they're old, old and crusty and weak and frail and okay, all right. They eventually decide after years have passed, they've wasted so much time. But all of that, God taught me, you're still in spiritual jail. You might be walking on the outside thinking that you're doing well, prospering. Mm-mm. You're in spiritual jail. So three things, three levels. One, you can immediately repent, even tonight. If you know you're having sex, even last night, you're going to have sex, you know, you can repent and say, God, beg you, I don't want to do it tonight.
Oh, Lord, forgive me that I did it last night, this morning, or even lunchtime, whenever after, whatever you did it. It's okay. It's okay. But I was like, God is faithful and just to forgive you. If you want, confess your sins. Not hide it. Not pretend it didn't happen. But if you confess it, all right, right away, you know, you hear the word, you're convicted, you know that, yes, that's me. You can be free right away. Two, you said, no, I'm going to sit down in jail a couple days, couple weeks, because, ooh, you know, you're just not going to let it go. Okay, all right, no problem. Tough guy, tough woman, okay. Then you got to get another chance. The third time, I don't know. You harden your heart so much till God can't talk to you, can't hear God. Everything that's shut up for you, upper doors close, you know, because you won't forgive. The choice is yours. But in short, I'm trying to say, you end up, you're still in spiritual jail, worse than physical jail. Pastor Marsha, I'm done talking. Are you muted? I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Sorry.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, sorry about that. Sorry about that, guys. Don't go, because I want you to pray for the sick. Prepare yourself. Yeah, you.
Who's that, me?
Yes, you.
Okay.
I'm going to pray for the sick, but I want to do this. I just want to play a little bit of the song. There's quite a few people that I know that's going through cancer, doing chemo, and you know, I just want you to pray for them in that realm so you can prepare yourself. I'm going to close at this. You know, God is a merciful God. One of the things that we don't want to do, we don't want to continue to ignore the prompting of the Holy Spirit. Because the more we ignore him, the more our hearts is going to be hardened. Yes. Till eventually, you'll just keep having sex and don't feel nothing. You don't feel no conviction, you know, nothing. And let me tell you something. When you get to that place, you are at a dangerous place. Because without conviction, there can be no repentance. Yeah. This is where you are now, where the wrong seems right to you. So all we're saying is this, as she said. We've all fallen short. I think it was Pastor Barbara said, you know, we've all done that when we didn't know better. But it's like when you know better, those who know better do better. And just the next time you have that urge, and we're taking it for ourselves too, because we are each soul too. You understand? The next time we have that urge, we're going to remember, is it worth it? Is this worth whatever 20 minutes, half an hour, 2 hours? Is it going to worth violating God? And am I willing to deal with the consequence? Just like me, and I'm closing. I love peanuts. I love it. I'm not supposed to eat it. I love nuts. I love coconuts. I love that. And I'm not supposed to eat it. And you know, I eat it. I always eat it. And then I suffer after. Why? I'm not supposed to have it tonight. And those who know me and around me, whenever, you know, I'm going to eat it, they say, you don't know you're not supposed to eat it. I'm in a business with you because guess what? I love it so much. And then now when I eat it, I'm in pain. I'm been up on something that I was in a hospital before for it. So then when I see people eating cashews and all those stuff, I ask myself the question, are you willing to go through the pain? You're going to enjoy eating it, but are you willing to go through the consequence after you've eaten it? And that's what we have to ask ourselves. Am I willing to deal with the consequence after this sexual act, knowing that I'm doing it outside of the covenant of marriage? I'll keep it up. Let us go to with this for a little bit. We're going to pray for the sick. Those who are cancer, whatever the sickness is tonight, you're sick, you know, the loved one that's sick. We're just going to ask you to come in agreement with us. We know that a God who is able to heal. Let's play a little bit of this. I want you to decree this over your life tonight. Yes, those of you, wherever you are listening to us from, decree that you're healed. Believe it for somebody. Yes. Whatever the sickness is, it could be emotional, psychological. Yes. It could be your neighbor, your friend, a colleague. You pray for them tonight. As Tamika prays for the sick tonight, we believe in God for his healing.
By the power of the Lamb and his authority, I stand. I am healed.
I am healed. I am forgiven. I am set free. Emotionally, I am giving God thanks tonight for healing me. Stripes, you are healed to the glory of God. Go ahead, Minister Tamika, as we pray for the sick. Yes, for those of you who are with us, if you know anyone that's sick, stand in the gap. If you're sick, believe God for your healing as we pray and we come in agreement. Go ahead, Minister Tamika.
Hallelujah. I'm going to say something before I start to pray. I was watching something today. It's a 7 days of prayer to consecrate oneself. And the lady said that God gave her, the first thing he told her to pray for day one was for forgiveness. She had an illness, and he says, because you haven't forgiven someone. And I'm not saying that's the reason for your illness. That's not what I'm saying. Because I believe that God, I remember years ago, I said to God, why do your people get sick? And very gently, I'm not going to say this covers all persons, but I understood that it goes for some people. He was saying to me, I need my people to go through things to show others how they can trust in him. And so God, sometimes you might be sick and God just wants you to be a light to somebody else. You might be in the hospital room and someone's next door that doesn't know God, and they're wondering, how come you have so much peace? How much you have so much joy? How come you're not worried about anything? And God wants you to represent for him. And yes, we might say, well, this is not good, but who else is going to represent for him? Who else is going to show the unsaved, or show those who feel like all hope is gone, how they can have hope while going through what they're going through? So, and then the other side is, I said, this lady mentioned unforgiveness, and the Lord said, God, I don't have any unforgiveness. And he started to show her
one particular person that had really hurt her, and then some other people later on. But she mentioned that unforgiveness was a cause to a sickness that kept bringing her into the hospital. Also, I remember years ago, my apostle said once that God showed her that some illnesses are associated with sin or with certain things. So again, people, she said, like arthritis for some people, the Lord showed her is people that have, unforgiveness, have a stiff neck, hardened their heart. They decided, I'm not this. So that stiffness in your body is representing stiffness in you. You're not pliable. You don't want to move on. You don't want to let go. There was another one that represented something. I don't remember it right now. It's a very common one. I don't know how it just lit me. So the arthritis. And there was something. Anyway, I don't remember. The point is, some things is related to something spiritually that we violated in God's word. Now, I'm not saying that's the case for you, but if anyone's listening and that could be the case for you, just go to God and say, Lord, forgive me for whatever area that I may have committed sin in. And if God wants you to just be a light to other people, that's wonderful also. Let me read some scripture before I start to pray. Psalms 30 verse 2 says, Lord, my God, I called to you for help and you healed me. Oh, yes. You can call out to the Most High God who will hear you. Who will hear you if you cry out to him for help. He'll reveal what he has revealed to you and he is able to heal you. Jeremiah 30 verse 17, but I will restore you to health and heal your wounds, declares the Lord. God is able to restore you to health. Not just good health, but perfect health. First Peter 2, verse 24 says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. And last, one of my favorite scriptures, 3 John 1, verse 2, beloved, I pray that all, not some, but all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. Is your soul well tonight? It's not about singing the song, it is well with my soul. Is your soul really, really well tonight? I'm not talking to those who are sick. I'm talking to everyone listening. Is your soul really well? Do you really know the Lord? Are you abiding in the vine? Are you dwelling in the secret place? Do you know him? Are you staying away from sin? Are you fleeing from sin? Are you shunning the appearance of evil? Are you trying to be holy as he is holy? Hallelujah. Oh God, we want to thank you for this night. We thank you for allowing us to gather here tonight. We thank you, Lord, for the law that was passed, a law that represents your law, your way, your word. and I want to say, Lord, it's unfortunate that it's not even a Christian country that is doing that. But God, even it just even shows that they don't have to be Christian to believe in what's right or to know what's right or to know that your way is the right way. We pray tonight, Lord, that any of us who is in sexual sin, who is shacking up, who is in common law relations, who is anything outside of your will, I pray tonight, Lord, that you would help us. Help us to wean out of that situation, Lord. Make a way, Lord, because many people can't legally, they don't see a way, but you're the way maker, God. As the songwriter says, when we don't see it, when we don't feel it, you're always, you're always doing something. You're always doing something. You're already ahead of us. So Lord, thank you for showing the way to get out of that thing, Lord, that displeases you, that thing that doesn't give you glory. Hallelujah. Lord, tonight, I present everyone tonight that is not well in their body, that may not be well in their mind. I pray even their soul, Lord. You know all things, Lord. Lord, we ask that you, the great physician, the one that nothing is too hard for, the impossible specialist, the miracle worker. We pray tonight, Lord, by the blood of Jesus that was shed for us. We thank you for the blood that will never lose its strength, the healing blood, the blood that is powerful, that reaches to the lowest valley. Mm-mm-mm. You can reach, Lord, high, high, high. We pray, Lord, that the blood tonight will do what only it can do through the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray, Lord, that healing, the healing virtue that left Jesus when the woman touched him, with the issue of blood. We pray, Lord, tonight for forgiveness for everyone, Lord, that is watching, that is listening, that may need healing. We ask, Lord, that you'd extend your mercy. Just like you, the word said that you ask if your hand is short. Mm-mm. Your mercy is not limited. Your grace is sufficient. And Lord, tonight we want to ask, we just thank you in advance, Lord, for the healing anointing. We thank you, Lord, that for the miracle worker that you are. We just declare that they are healed tonight in the name of Jesus, from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet. I pray wherever they are that the angels, the healing angels will go to them and give them whatever they need, whether they need a replacement of something, they need a touch of something, whatever it is, Lord, I pray even now they will testify that they've been touched. Oh, yes. Songwriter said, he touched me and made me whole. Yes, Lord, do what only you can do. Touch each and every one of us tonight, not just those sick in body, but those sick in other areas. We just want to thank you tonight, Lord, because we know that you are a God that answers, the God that hears and the God that sees, the God that knows and the God that's able, the God that's willing and the God that will do. We call upon you, Lord, tonight. And we say thank you in advance for your healing power. We thank you tonight, Lord, for your grace, for your mercy, for your love, your forgiveness. We thank you, Abba Father, for being a good, good God, a good, good Father, a good, good everything to us. May we rely only in you. May we seek only you. May we be comforted by you. May everything in us that is, out of control appetite be crucified even now in the name of Jesus. Help us, Lord, to curb, to bring into order those things that are out of order in our lives so that we don't need any law, no policeman to police us, but only your Holy Spirit. We give you praise tonight. Bless Real Talk Ministry. Bless the host. I just pray, Lord, that you'll open up doors for her, Lord. I pray showers of blessings. I pray that she'll continue to shed light on topics that are not spoken about publicly and openly. May we always be people of truth, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen, amen to my nice, clean, brown friend. To God, yes. Stay tuned next week. We're going to be back, Tamika and myself. I was going to confirm some things, and then we are going to send out a post. Yes, as we're going to come with our end of year health watch, which is going to include a lot of things there. So look forward to that next week. And quickly, one more announcement before I go. Thank you for staying with us. We did start at 8:30, so it might seem like we've been on long, but I think it was well worth it. You know, when you were praying, it just came to mind. This show reminds me of some church service when you go, you understand, where the pin drop, you know, you don't hear nothing. Like, you understand, I'm trying to say that means people are listening, people are taking it in. So I thank you for joining. I thank you for your comments. And I mean, if you go to the word, go and read it for yourself. You'll see that what you're saying, it is truth. And it's something that we must live by. And that's the word of God. One announcement, January the 7th. I just want to put a quick plug in. The flyer is coming out this weekend. For those of you, each and every one of you out there, you're interested in prison ministry. You're interested in getting into youth detention centers. You're interested in, being mentors to people who are coming out of prison or in halfway houses, women's shelter, anything like that, any area of ministry outside of your church. We're not calling you to a church. We're not calling you to join an organization. We're just calling you to give an opportunity to use your gifts that God has given you. I'll be hosting a information session that will give you all the details, all the information you need into the avenues and areas that you want to minister to. And out of that, if you desire to be trained for any of those
because we want to allow you to do that. It's time for us to work, but it's still day. You know, there's so much opportunities. I want to get into the institution in Kingston, glory to God, where a lot of our young men are, but I don't want to reach out and then I don't have the bodies, right? Glory to God, lots of things happening. Halfway houses are asking for people to come in to do Bible study. We need people at the prison to teach Bible study. They're asking lots of things to do. So again, January the 7th, you'll hear more about it from 10 to 12. It's in Mississauga. I will give you all the details of the flyer. But yeah, I'm just throwing it out there. Come and listen and get the information and then make the decision as to where you want to go. All right. Remember, it's only what we do for Christ will last. Let us get out in the community. Yes, let's reach out to our lost and those who are, you know, in prison and in communities, halfway house, women's shelters, youth facilities, drug pit stops where they get detox. We need help everywhere. All right. Wherever you are, I just want to say, well, thank you, Sister Tamika, for coming on. She's right. I called the last minute. Girl, listen, what are you doing tonight? You're free. You're going to come on me. And I'm telling you, it was really good. I like the dialogue and I trust that you were blessed by it. Wherever you are around the world, Jesus is Lord to the glory of God. Remember, you have the heart of a champion, the mind of an overcomer, the spirit of more than a conqueror, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Remember, you are a lit candle. Go out and light your world. Glory to God. Yes, go out and be the hand of God extended and his voice in the earth, loving someone back to life and destiny. If it's the will of God, I'll see you here tomorrow. Yes, new day with Vivian, which is our daily devotion coming to you through our YouTube channel, Glory to God, streaming right here on Facebook for your convenience. All right. Good night to the entire world.